بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله. All praises are due to Allah, the creator, the cherisher and the sustainer of this universe, and may his peace and blessings be upon his noble prophet Muhammad and his companions and descendants and followers. Dear respected brothers and sisters, welcome to the sixth session of the spiritual purification workshop, which is eight sessions. We will have two more sessions after Ramadan inshallah. The last session was called Spiritual Jihad, and it's a very important one, and those who did not do their homework should do it. Please buy your kafan and hang it with your clothes at home. Don't hang it on a side. Hang it in a way that reminds you with death every time before you go, so that you don't commit any injustices towards anyone. Actually, one of the brothers here told me something that happened to him next day after last week's session. You need to humble yourself. He was actually on the tube, and he had a sudden cough, and the tube was actually the train was empty nearly. Yani there was no one. No, yani he didn't cough in the face of anyone, but from the other side of the train, a woman very loudly shouted at him, "Put your hand on your mouth when you cough in public." And he said, "That was so embarrassing for me, so embarrassing." And at the beginning, I was about to give her the normal response, which is mind your own business or anything like that. And then he said, "I remembered last week's session and that we need to humble ourselves." And then I thought to myself, she didn't say anything wrong. It's true, I did not put my hand on my mouth. So I said, thank you. This is the change that should happen to us. Change. Okay? Anyway, let's start. Today's session is called Besieging Your Ego. How can you limit your ego? How can you besiege your ego? How can you have immunity from spiritual weaknesses, especially pride? Number one, pride happens when we receive ni'mah from Allah. Sometimes people receive ni'mah, and instead of thanking the one, the mun'im, the one who gives us the ni'mah, the one who gave us the gift, we thank others. First of all, we thank ourselves. So when you get a job, and someone tells you, "Oh wow, mashallah, you got a job in Tesco." You say, "Yeah, actually, because I applied in many companies and I was good in my interviews, so I got a job." Or for example, you got a scholarship in Imperial College. So instead of thanking Allah, you say, "Yeah, I got scholarship because my grades were very good and my reputation is good among my teachers and among my professors." You forget who gave you this. You're blessed with a beautiful child. MashaAllah, a healthy baby. Yeah, we are following up with a good doctor. And my wife didn't take any medication during pregnancy, and that's why we got a healthy baby. You forgot. We always forget. Or you get cured from a fatal disease, like cancer or something. Yeah, medicine developed so much, actually, progressed well. And I went to the best doctors, actually. I went private. So you keep thanking yourself for your smartness, for your intelligence, and you thank the doctors, and you thank science, but you don't thank Allah. So what you need to do, when you receive a gift from Allah, number one, refer the gift to the giver quickly. Quickly, before shaitan starts whispering to you. So as soon as you receive the gift, refer it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mu'minun, speaking to Prophet Nuh, فَإِذَا اسْتَوَيْتَ أَنْتَ وَمَنْ مَعَكَ عَلَى الْفُلْكِ فَقُلِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي نَجَّانَا مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. And when you and your companions are settled on the ark, say, "Praise be to God, who saved us from the wicked people. Don't say, yeah, it's a strong one, it's a strong ark. We actually spent a long time building it. Yeah, I used the best type of wood. Number one, thank Allah. Always thank Allah. Quickly, as soon as you receive a gift, thank Allah quickly. You got a job, you say, God blessed me with a job. Alhamdulillah, after applying in many companies. See the difference? Not because I applied in many companies, I got a job. No. Allah blessed me with a job after I applied in many companies. You could have applied in many companies and still didn't get a job. Still could have not got a job. You got a scholarship. You always have to say, God blessed me with a scholarship after I applied in many universities. Refer quickly. Mention quickly the giver before shaitan whispers to you and make you forget. You got a beautiful baby. You should just say, God blessed us with a beautiful baby. They're following up with many doctors, with good doctors. But always mention Allah. Always keep him in mind. He said, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Keep me in mind, I keep you in mind. Mention me, I mention you. Keep him in mind. And Ramadan is a good chance. A good chance. It is the month of the Quran. Read Quran in this month. Actually, I like reading in many things, but in Ramadan, I only read Quran. Only read Quran. 3, 4, 5, 6 hours. And if you don't understand Arabic, you have to read the translation. So you read the Arabic and you read the translation. And ponder. And reflect upon the meanings. Fetch the messages. Think, what are the messages that he is trying to send to you? Quran is a chance for us to be better. Actually, how can I know after Ramadan that Allah accepted my Ramadan, my fasting, and my good deeds? There is a alama. There is a mark that if you see it, you know that Allah accepted your good deed. Which is, if your behavior after your good deed is better than it is before the good deed. Which means you prayed after the prayer. If your status is better, if your behavior is better, this means that Allah accepted your prayer. After Ramadan, if your status is better than before Ramadan, then Allah accepted your Ramadan. So it's a chance. It's a chance. أطب مطعمك تكون مستجاب الدعوة. Purify your food or choose the best food. You become the one whom Allah responds to his dua. What food? The money should be halal. Number one. So your money should be halal. At the same time, if you are eating any haram, like, for example, nicotine, it's a chance. I know a very special person for me who just informed me now that she just smoked one cigarette today, getting ready for Ramadan, because she's planning to stop in Ramadan. Put a plan and gradually stop. Get rid of bad habits. It's a chance. Back to our topic. You got, for example, you were cured from a fatal disease like cancer, for example. Quickly mention Allah. Say, I got cured. Alhamdulillah, Allah cured me from cancer after going to the best doctors. Because you could have gone to the best doctors and still die. People go to the best doctors and die, for your own information. You took the strongest medicine. There are people who took the same medicine and died. It's Allah who puts the cure in the medicine. It's not the medicine. Medicine doesn't cure. And to prove this to you, bring two people from the same sex, of the same weight, and of the same age, and having the same illness. You give them, they go to the same doctor, they take the same medicine, one of them gets cured and the other one dies. So Allah have put the cure in this medicine that this man took and did not put it here. That's it. Everything is by the hand of Allah. Don't forget yourself. Second, you received a ni'mah. Quickly do sujood. Sujood is shukr. Sajdat is shukr. Showing gratitude of Allah. You do sujood, thanking Allah for this ni'mah. And sajdat is shukr should be long. So you heard the good news. Wherever you are, you make sujood for Allah. See though the Algerian players who made sujood in the match? That's good. That's good. Wherever you are, you make sujood. Even some ulama excluded sajdat al-shukr from the conditions of prayers. They said, if you don't have wudu, do it. Just do it. If you don't know the qibla, do it in any direction. It should be long. Speak to Allah in your sujood. Tell him that without him, you could have never got that gift. Without you, O Allah, I could have never got it. Without your generosity, without your mercy, I could have never got it. I could have never got that job. I could have never got that baby. I could have never got that scholarship. I could have never got cured from cancer. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah explains the importance of immediate showing gratitude, that you immediately show gratitude. And he said, because gifts make people happy, and this leads to pride and arrogance. So Allah gives you a gift, and you start to be pleased with this gift, and you forget about the giver, and then you start to feel proud of yourself. You have a good position in a big company, and you forgot. You just forgot who gave it to you. So Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah said, immediate gratitude is very important because gifts can make you proud of yourself and arrogant, which Allah hates so much. And this can lead to that this gift become a trap. Some gifts are a trap, a bait. Istidraj. You can be tustadraj. You can be trapped using a gift. Shaitan can trap you. So what you need to do? Here, if you get trapped, the gift can vanish quickly and you can lose this gift. While receiving it with sujood al-shukr, the sajda of al-shukr, you make sujood to Allah and humbling yourself, showing servitude, showing ubudiyyah, makes it last and makes it real, a real gift, not a trap. A real blessing, you make sujood. Three. So we said, when you receive a gift, refer it to the giver. Say, Allah gave me this gift. Second, make sujood al-shukr. Three, exaggerate in humbling yourself. You became a CEO of a company or a managing director. Humble yourself. Shake hands with the poor people. Sit with them. Eat with them. The Prophet ﷺ used to accept the invitations of slaves. A slave inviting him to have lunch with him. Probably there isn't the best food. Probably he will not feed him seafood. But he goes to find just bread. But he goes. Humble yourself. Sit with the poor people. Sit with the less fortunate. Shake their hands. And pray sunan and nawafil and extra good deeds and extra prayers. And stand up the night in adoration for Allah. He gave you a position. He gave you a scholarship. Stand up at night. People are in their cozy beds. And you are with your loved one. You are with your loved one, calling upon him, speaking to him, reading his words. So this is important. Lady Aisha used to say, actually asked, she asked the Prophet ﷺ, why he prays a lot until his feet swell if Allah had forgave him all his sins, past and future sins. He said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا? Shouldn't I be thankful, a thankful servant? So be thankful. Be thankful for Allah. He gave us a lot of gifts. The biggest gift is what?
Islam.
The biggest gift is that you were born Muslim, or Allah guided you to Islam. You could have been worshipping a human being right now. You could have been worshipping a cow or an animal right now. Actually, 1 billion people in this world worship cows. You could have been worshipping a stone. Allah makes the system in this world like that. Every creature, Allah created different types of creatures. And Allah made the system that every creature is in the service of the higher rank creatures, not the opposite. So Allah created non-living things like water, soil. And Allah created a higher rank creatures than the non-living. Allah created plants. And Allah created a higher rank creature than plants, animals. Allah created a higher rank creature than animals, human beings. And he made the system that every creature is in the service of the higher rank creatures, not the opposite. So you see, water and soil serve plants. Plants don't serve water and soil. And they serve also animals. And they serve us. Plants serve animals. Animals are vegetarian. They eat plants. And they serve us. We also eat plants. And animals serve us. They don't serve plants. We ride the animals. We eat the meat of the animals. We drink the milk of the animals. And we wear the leather of the animals. And we are what? Servants of Allah. We are on the top of the pyramid of creation. Only if we are Muslims. Only if the human being is a Muslim, he is on the top of the pyramid of creation. Because had this human being been, for example, yani worshipping another human being like him, he has to go one rank down to worship a human being. One rank lower than human beings to worship a human being. And to worship an animal, you have to go two ranks down to worship an animal. Who puts you in your real rank? Who honored you as a human being and made you on the top of the pyramid? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by making you Muslim. It is the biggest gift in the world. The biggest gift in the world. Thank Allah. And thank Allah for the other gifts. The gift that we don't feel. You remember the homework of the swimming goggles that blinds you up? People here who are very consistent with their homework couldn't do more than 3 times a week. They could not voluntarily give up the seeing sense for half an hour, just half an hour every day. They couldn't. Thank Allah for this gift. Thank Allah for your children. Thank Allah for your... We have a lot of gifts. And then we say, many of us say, all my life has been very difficult and like hell. Come on, come on. Thank Allah for your gifts. You are gifted. Wallahi, you are gifted. Just focus on the gifts. Last time I said, have the eye of the bee, not the eye of the fly. The bee sees the flowers and it lands on them and smells them. The fly sees the dirty things and it lands on them and smells them. And both will always be in this world, dirty things and flowers. If you have the eye of the bee, you will live a better life than if you have the eye of the fly. The fifth thing that you need to do when you receive a gift. This gift itself should make you worried. That there can be consequences for this gift. Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali says, وَأَمَّا الْعُلَمَاءُ فَلَا تَعْظُمُ هَذِهِ الْخَوَارِقُ عِنْدَهُمْ بَلْ يَرَوْنَ الزُّهْدَ فِيهَا. He said, knowledgeable people are not happy with these gifts, but rather they renounce it, يزهدون يعني فيها, and see it as a possible fitna or a test, and that dunya is made available to the servant who should focus on the hereafter. They fear becoming busy with this gift and then become attracted to this life pleasures. So when you are gifted a position in a company, something like that, this should make you worry that it can have consequences, which means this position can make you busy and decrease your ibadah and decrease your good deeds and decrease your volunteering time that you give. You volunteer in the mosque, you volunteer with organizations. So yani this gift, you should look at it also, thank Allah, and at the same time should make you worry about yourself. Take the position, but at the same time think about the good deeds that you're doing and don't decrease it. Don't let it be a fitna for you. For example, we have here some examples. Someone called Ibrahim al-Husari, he entered and he met Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and he told him, my mom saw you in the vision, saw a good dream for you. And it is so and so, and it's like she saw you in heaven, she saw you in paradise. So Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, brother, Sahl ibn Salama, people used to see him also in paradise in their dreams, and then he went out killing people among the Khawarij. So he didn't say, wallahi, your mom saw that I am in paradise, mashallah, looks like inshallah I'm going to paradise. Oh, no, it's not comforting him. He said, well, some other people used to be like that, and then they ended up killing people in the streets. And we have seen that in Egypt, by the way. We have seen people whom we thought they are pious and righteous, and then they give fatwa that to kill peaceful protesters. We have seen that. So when someone gives you some good news like that, don't take it in a way that can cause fitna for you. Say, not necessarily that this is right. Maybe this is just a false dream. Don't comfort yourself. Always be worried. We are living for moments. You are in a test. Succeed in this test. Don't let these things be a trap for you. Should we be happy then with the gifts of Allah or not? Should we be happy with the gifts of Allah? There is good happiness and bad happiness. The good happiness that we should feel is to be happy that Allah gave you or made you able to obey Him. So for example, you stood up and you prayed Taraweeh, or you prayed alone at night, standing the night in adoration for Allah. After that, your happiness should be, you're happy because you stood up and you, no, your happiness should be that Allah made you able to do that. That Allah chose you to be among the few people who are worshipping Him tonight, while many others are in pubs and discos. You could have been one of them. Always refer the gift to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Yunus, verse number 58, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. SubhanAllah, this verse used Dr. Morsi to say it a lot. Say, Prophet, say, in God's grace and mercy, let them rejoice. So rejoice, feel happy with the grace of Allah that He gave you. This should make you happy. Not the gift itself, but that He gave you should make you happy. وَيَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ. On that day, the believers will rejoice at God's help. They are happy not because they were victorious. No, they are happy because God gave them victory. There's bad happiness, which is to be proud of yourself and your capabilities and your strengths. Your strengths. You have strengths. If you're happy with the strengths, happy with your capabilities and your intelligence, this can lead you to be like Qarun. قارون ساد. سورة القصص إذ قال له قومه لا تفرح إن الله لا يحب الفرحين. هساد قال إنما أوتيته على علم عندي. قارون said, his people said to him, do not gloat or act arrogantly, for God does not like people who gloat. And his answer was, this wealth was given to me on account of knowledge that I possess, not because Allah gave it to me, because I know I am knowledgeable. It is said that he used to memorize the whole Torah. He was one of the Israelites, by the way, which means that he was one of the Muslim Ummah at that time. Because when I say the Israelites, you need to understand that the Israelites were the Muslim Ummah at that time. Second, when you succeed in doing something, so the first thing was when you receive a gift from Allah. Second, when you become successful, an achiever, you achieved something that you wanted. For example, you scored a goal, or you should always, again, refer it to Allah, as we said. You stood up the night in adoration, praying with Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran, refer it to Allah, as we said. You made dua, and your dua was responded to. This can be a trap. Many of us think, Allah, alhamdulillah, I never make dua, and I don't see it happening. Wow. And people look at him highly. Oh, this is a holy man, godly man. This can be a trap. This can be a trap. You got promoted in your work to a higher position than your colleagues. Don't say because I'm intelligent, because I'm active, because I'm productive. It's true that you can be intelligent and active and productive, but there are so many people who are more intelligent, more active, more productive, and they do not get promoted. Always remember that it is the tawfiq of Allah. It is the success that Allah gave it to you. So here what you need to do is do good deeds and keep them secret. I don't know if I told you this story or not, but when I started giving the da'wah and so on, I was afraid of pride and riya. So I chose one of the very famous people who are known for being a very humble person. And I went to him, and he is looked at like a hero. This is someone who went to this jail of Nasser in the 50s, early 50s. And he stayed there for 20 years. And he could have got out with a simple signature saying, I support President Nasser. He could have got out. He refused. He said, no, I'm not going to sign such a simple phrase. I'm not going to do that. So he got out in 1974. People look at him highly. And he is extremely humble. And I went to him especially to ask him, how can I be that humble? How can I avoid riya? Riya, which is it's a disease that comes to the heart, which is seeking the admiration of people. You want people to admire you. He said, why would you have riya? I said, because I started to do some public work. He said, okay, so this is something that you cannot do in secret. I said, no, I can't do it. I can't give a lesson in a mosque in secret yet. He said, okay, then let me tell you. Do other good deeds secretly, and let it be 1,000 times more than what you do in public. By the way, I'm not doing this. Don't think that I'm saying, but I'm telling you, that was his advice to me. If you do this and that in public, do much more secretly, and don't inform anyone with it. So you will be having a reserve, a secret life between you and Allah. And what people know is nothing besides this. So you will not have, you will not fear riya. They will look at you highly for doing it. Doing this and that, you're doing much more between you and Allah. So this means that you should have your secret life with Allah. Yeah. Have a secret life with Allah.
كان الصحابي يخادع زوجته كما تخادع الأم وليدها. A companion used to walk out on his toes when his wife sleeps, like a mom walks out on her toes when her newborn baby sleeps. You know, a mom, a new mom, she had a newborn baby who keeps crying all the time. As soon as the baby sleeps, she puts the baby very, very slowly and she walks out on her toes to have some rest or to do something and cook something quickly. When the companion used to see his wife asleep like that, he used to walk out on his toes and pray. And then remove all the things that can show that next day they can show that dad was praying. Eh? The rug is put, the mushaf is opened. No, remove everything, back. No one should know. It's true that maybe you're an example for your wife. Maybe you're an example for your kids. Then let them know 1/100 of what you do. But not all. وَكُلُّهُمْ آتِيهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَرْدًا. Everyone will come on the day of judgment individually. You're not coming with your wife on the day of judgment. You're not coming with your children on the day of judgment. Only between you and Allah. Humble yourself to Allah. Always try to, if a deed, a good deed can be done secretly, then do it secretly. Because when you do it secretly, you're avoiding the praise that will come to you from people. Because people see you taking out 50 pounds and looking at it like that, and then you drop it in the box. People say, MashaAllah, this brother is a donor. This brother is a... Secretly. Not even after Jum'ah, because there are many people. Just secretly. Make sure that people don't know what you're doing. As if you're stumbling and falling and falling down, so you're just leaning on the box and then you drop it, okay? Yeah, try to do it secretly, yes. Deceive people in this. Don't show it for people. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ يُحِبُّ الْعَبْدَ التَّقِيَّ الْخَفِيِّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the servant who is righteous and the one whom not much about him is known for people. I have seen that among the shuhada of Rab'ah. Brothers, wallahi, I will tell you something that I never said in public. You know that in Bridges Foundation, we do films and episodes about how to refute misconceptions. I had a misconception that I couldn't find an answer for, except at the day of Rab'ah, when Rab'ah was dispersed. It is al-istishhad fi sabilillah. It is a misconception for me, by the way. For many years, I didn't understand. How come someone keeps going to the mosque 5 times every day for 70 years, and he is paying his zakah, and he's doing hajj and everything, and then he will be held accountable before Allah on the day of judgment, and he may even be punished a little bit, at least. And someone else, who's doing everything wrong, and then he stands up for half an hour defending the truth, and he gets a bullet by coincidence, he goes like that to Jannah. Shaheed. Excuse me. This man spent 70 years doing good deeds. And this man, just because by coincidence he got a bullet for taking a strong position once in his life, like that. And then I found, no one goes shaheed by coincidence. When I became like surrounded by shuhada, we discovered that they are the best from every group. The bullets were choosing the best, not anyone. Someone came to me actually after this, 2 months after this, going in the protests and people getting killed, and he said, I am angry. I am so upset. Why am I not dying as a shaheed? People are falling around me. I told him, do you pray Qiyam al-Layl? He said, no. I said, do you read at least Quran for an hour every day and you do tadabbur? He said, no. I said, how come you want to die as a shaheed? You think anyone like that? This is, so actually brothers, I'm saying this because those brothers, when we studied their life, they were all akhfiya. They were among the people whom no one knows anything about them. They sit, they don't talk. When they are not here, they are not missed. They are not this kind of people whom, you know, cool guys. Khalas. Wallahi, we made an endeavor that we go and make hajj for them. So one of them, I called his father because we're asking if they made hajj before or not. If they made hajj before, we choose someone else. So I asked one of them, I asked his father, did Islam do hajj? He said, I don't know. I said, what? You don't know if your son made hajj or not? He said, I used to work in the Gulf, me and his mother, and he didn't really talk much. I heard that he wanted to go to hajj, but I don't know if he went or not. They're not the kind of people who go back and keep talking about what happened, and I went, and I bought sandwiches, and blah, blah, blah. They just sit like that. Akhfiya. Humble, very humble. Not talkative. Look at how people cry in Taraweeh. Ramadan is coming. You will see people crying in the Taraweeh. Muhammad ibn Wasi', one of the students of the students of the Sahaba, تابعي التابعين, he said, أدركت رجالا كان الرجل يكون رأسه مع رأس امرأته على وسادة واحدة وقد بل ما تحت خده من دموعه لا تشعر به امرأته. I have seen people whom one of them used to put his head on the same pillow that his wife is putting her head on, and his side is soaked wet of his tears, but she doesn't feel. And you see people shaking like that in Taraweeh. He wants to tell you, hey, I'm crying. Excuse me, I'm crying. Are you really crying out of fear of Allah or not? Even this you want to show up with? Actually, also one of the things, one of the nice stories that Sheikh called Umar al-Misani mentioned about his murabbi. His murabbi is called Sheikh Hassan al-Banna. He took him once in a trip in Egypt, in the train. Of course, Sheikh Hassan al-Banna used to take trains second class, not first class. Of course, you don't know what is second class in Egypt, yani. There's no glass, nothing, yani. But anyway, and when Sheikh Hassan al-Banna used to be asked, yani, why do you always insist on taking second class? He said, because there is no third class. But anyway, Sheikh Umar al-Misani said, he went with him. It was a long trip to the Sa'id, Upper Egypt. As soon as they arrived to the station, there were like thousands of people waiting for the Sheikh. They received him, they took him to the mosque. He gave a lesson, thousands of people are there. And after he finished, people took him to where he would take to a house to take dinner and sleep. They took dinner with the hosts, and then they did not leave them except after midnight, like 12:30 or 1 o'clock. And Fajr is about 4 o'clock. There's only 3 hours left to sleep. He said, they took us to the room where we will spend the night. Every one of us went to his bed. Assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum assalam, turned off the light. He said, after 15 minutes, I was still awake because it was a very tiring day and I had my feet aching. I couldn't sleep easily. So Sheikh Hassan al-Banna called me, Umar. So I said, yes, Sheikh. He said, are you still awake? He said, yeah, I'm still awake, Sheikh. He said, no, it's time to sleep. There's only 3 hours left to wake up. He said, okay, Sheikh. 15 more minutes, Umar. He said, yes, Sheikh. He said, are you still awake? He said, Sheikh, I'm trying to sleep. He said, okay, yeah, we have to sleep. 15 more minutes, and he said, Umar. He said, I did not respond to him. I really wanted to know what he wants. Umar again. He said, I did not respond. Third Umar. Umar, I did not respond. He said, I found him getting up from his bed, praying the night in adoration for Allah. He could have said to himself, I'm an example for him.
I am his murabbi. Yeah, Umar, wake up. Let's pray the night in adoration for Allah.
No, keep some, have a secret life with Allah. This should be your the closest to you. Khalas. Don't attempt to make people praise you. This is called istintaq al-nas. You want people to praise you. So for example, after I finish today, I ask people, what do you think about this lesson? And people start, what am I expecting? Mashallah, oh, of course. Actually, I'm not really seeking your feedback. If I really want your feedback, there should be like an evaluation form, and you don't put your name, and you'll be criticizing. But when you ask people, when you do anything for them, you ask them, what do you think about this or that? What are you expecting them to say? Compliments. Compliments. So don't seek the compliments. Don't seek praise. If you're really sincere and you really want to know feedback, distribute an evaluation form. But don't seek compliments from people. Also, you should undermine your own deeds. So when you do a good deed, tell yourself, I'm not the first one to do that, and I'm not the last one to do that. For example, you did any service for the community. Don't start thinking about yourself, like I did something good, yeah, alhamdulillah, you know what? I think many people are benefiting from what I did. No, tell yourself, I'm not the first one, not the last one. Undermine your own deeds. Don't keep track of your good deeds. Don't register them. Don't keep remembering your good deeds. One of the gifts of Allah that we forget our good deeds. Can you imagine that you are able now to remember every good deed that you did? You won't keep doing deeds. You'll say, that's enough. I did a lot. But one of the gifts of Allah that we forget our good deeds. Remember the bad deeds. They should scare you. They should scare you. That's what one of the companions said. That, actually it's a hadith, that al-fasiq, the rebellious person, a bad Muslim, would see his sins just like a fly, which is flying around his nose, and he just do like that to it. And a mu'min, a true believer, would see his very simple mistakes like a big mountain about to collapse on him. Remember the bad deeds. Put your head on the floor in sujood and say, oh Allah, I'm a criminal. I need you. Please forgive me. Cry. So I want you also to be very afraid of pride and ujb. Always make sure that you don't have pride, and at the same time have what's called pridophobia. I want you to have pridophobia, which is being afraid of pride, because it is the biggest disease that comes to the heart, the biggest spiritual weakness. Go to the second session of this workshop and watch it all over again about pride and the danger of pride. Pride, for your own information, is a type of shirk. Shirk. Polytheism. This is pride. Because here it is shirk fil asma' wa sifat. You forget that he is al-wahhab, the giver. You forget that he is the razzaq, the sustainer. You think yourself the wahhab. You think yourself the razzaq. So pride is a type of shirk, a degree of shirk. Be afraid of pride. It's risk. It's a risk. Alhamdulillah. Pride also nullifies your good deeds. So you can do a good deed and it's not counted. Not only that, it can lead you to hellfire if you have pride. The hadith of Prophet Muhammad says, أول من تسعر بهم النار عالم ومنفق وشهيد. The first three people who will be thrown in hellfire are عالم, a scholar. The first three people to be thrown in hellfire will be a scholar and a donor and a shaheed, a martyr. And the scholar will say, God, I used to teach people in mosques. And he will be told, no, not for the sake of Allah. You are doing this to be told and to be looked at as a knowledgeable person. And it was said. You got it. The donor, oh Allah, I used to spend for your sake. No. You used to spend publicly so that people would say about you, Kareem, Jawad, generous. And it was said about you. It was written. And the third would say, oh Allah, I was killed in battle for your sake. You would be told, no, you did this so that people would say, he's courageous, he's brave. And it was told, punished. Now you're punished. Allah doesn't care except about our sincerity. He said so in the Quran. لَنْ يَنَالَ اللَّهَ لُحُومُهَا وَلَا دِمَاؤُهَا وَلَكِنْ يَنَالُهُ التَّقْوَى مِنْكُمْ. Allah does not care about the flesh or the blood of the sacrifice that you do in Eid. He cares about your sincerity. Are you sincere or not? Pride brings the wrath of Allah. The anger of Allah. What are you proud of? He gives you. And then you thank someone else? Pride repels people in this life from you. When you're proud of yourself, when you're arrogant, people start to be repelled. They stay away from you. They say, he's an arrogant person. We don't like to be with him. So this is something also that can happen to you in this life with your with the people around you. People start to take a side from. They don't like it. Every time they sit with you, you keep talking about yourself. And it leads to the failure and to the deprivation of the support of Allah. Allah will not ever support someone who's proud of himself. And it leads to fitna in religion, tribulation and deterioration of your religion. And we have seen, wallahi, a lot of that. We have seen people like that. You become haunted with lusts and desires because you're proud of yourself. You're arrogant, so you want to please yourself. You feel like you deserve more. So you're haunted by lusts and desires. And it leads to a bad end. سوء خاتمة. أعوذ بالله. نعوذ بالله من سوء الخاتمة. We seek refuge with Allah from having a bad end. Yeah? Like someone praying four rak'ahs and just before saying Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, just before it, he passes some gas. Nothing. خلاص. He has to repeat all the four rak'ahs again. Exactly, this life is like that. Before your death, if you change to worse, العبرة بخواتيم الأعمال. What is counted is the last thing that you do. Wow. That's why Abu Hanifa used to tell his students, أنتم تخافون الذنوب وأنا أخاف الكفر. You fear sins, I fear kufr. Can you imagine this? And we have seen this, even the Anbiya asking Allah to give them thabat in this deen. So, okay, what can we do when we are praised? Actually, we get praised. You meet people who praise you. And praising is what? Is the wine of the spirit. You know, when people drink wine, they get high. They become intoxicated. Your spirit gets high and intoxicated with this wine, which is praise, when you're praised. So what can we do? You know, praising is like slaughtering. The Prophet ﷺ said that al-madh is dhabh, is like slaying someone. Someone praised someone else, and the Prophet ﷺ told him, whoa, you have cut your brother's neck. Had he hear you, he would never be successful. Which means that he didn't even praise him in his presence. And then the Prophet said, if you really have to praise a brother, then you should say, I think he is so-and-so. I think he is truthful. I think he is good in doing this. I think. Don't be absolute. And then you say, وَاللَّهُ حَسِيبُهُ وَلَا أُزَكِّي عَلَى اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. And I do not and I do not praise him, only Allah knows the reality. So you say, this brother is good, this brother is talented. No, you don't say, you say, I think this brother is talented, I think this brother can do that, and only Allah knows. This is the most that you can do. Okay, but when people praise you, what do you do to them? Don't respond to them, so as not to encourage them. Don't even thank them. Don't say, oh, thank you very much for, okay. No. Then they will praise you again. When someone praises you, you're like that. Don't give him a reaction so that he stops doing that again. So don't do that. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, someone praised him in his face. And then he told him, if you really know about myself what I know, you won't even look at my face. So you can speak ill about yourself when you're praised. To stop them from doing this and not encouraging them from doing that. Hassan al-Basri taught his students that when someone praises you by telling you, for example, I watch you when you make salah, mashallah ala al-khushu', oh, you have big khushu' in salah. You have a lot of consciousness of Allah. And ما أقل التفاتك في الصلاة التفاتك في الصلاة. You don't even look around you. You're just calm. You're focusing. So when someone tells you that, tell him, brother, and did you see where my heart and my mind are? When I'm in salah, maybe I'm daydreaming. Okay. So don't allow them to praise you like that. It is wine. You can get intoxicated by this praising. Ahmad ibn Hanbal was told, do you know how many people are making dua for you every single day? So his tears came to his eyes and he said, I'm afraid that this can be a trick. That I can be tricked like that. This can be a trap. When I see people making dua for me, probably I'm going to Jannah. No. So he said, still, I will not be comfortable. Another person from Khurasan told him, I came all the way from Khurasan to see you. Alhamdulillah that I met you. He said, sit here. Who do you think am I? Who am I to come from Khurasan to see me? So this is how they used to deal with praisers and people who praise. Actually, the Prophet ﷺ said, احثوا التراب في وجه المدحين, which means throw dust in the face of a praiser. This doesn't mean to throw dust physically. Here I have a problem with the brothers who understand things literally. The Prophet said, throw dust in their faces. Oh, did any one of the companions throw dust in the faces of anyone? The companions were always praised by the students and the next generation, but they did not throw dust in the faces of anyone. So this means what? Don't respond to them. Don't encourage them. Don't give them, don't even smile at them when they do so. But not literally throwing dust in the face of someone who tells you you're so good or something like that. But don't respond to them. A man told Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn Khattab, you are the best of people and the son of the best of people. He came, come here. Neither I nor my father are the best of people. And you will keep doing this to the man until he faces his destruction. So he even blamed the man who's praising him, and he told him, don't stop doing this. Stop doing this. It's risky. It puts us in risk. It puts us in danger. Neither I nor my father are the best of people, and stop doing this to people. People will be destroyed when they keep hearing you praising them like that. Okay, what if you do a service for people that you know that after doing this service, people will go like, wow, thank you very much. What do you do? When you do this service for people, ask them to thank Allah, not anyone else. This is what Umar ibn Abdul Aziz did when he sent a letter to the people of one of the cities, proclaiming to them good news for them, things that they always wanted. And he said, when this letter arrives and it is read for you, thank Allah and don't thank anyone except him. Thank him that He did not leave me for my own self, or I could have been like others before me. Sending them good news and telling them, don't thank anyone except Allah. Do that. We fall into arrogance and pride always when we sit with people. I'm not telling you not to sit with people, not at all. I'm not asking you to be for living a life of solitude at all. But don't sit with people who do nothing and just talk about themselves. Sit with people when you are planning to do something good. To plan to do good. To plan to do some voluntary work. To do any good for the community. Otherwise, don't waste your time just sitting and saying, yeah, we're socializing. Socializing doing what? Everyone is speaking about himself. So sit with people when there is something beneficial. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا من أمر بصدقة أو معروف أو إصلاح بين الناس. There is no good in most of their secret talk, only in commanding charity or good or reconciling between people. So, socialize with people and sit with people when you are doing something good. في البر والتقوى. When you are doing birr or taqwa. Good and righteousness. Actually, the Prophet ﷺ praised those who interact with people, not those who take a side from people. And he said, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنَ الَّذِي يُخَالِطُ النَّاسَ وَيَصْبِرُ عَلَىٰ أَذَاهِمْ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الَّذِي لَا يُخَالِطُ النَّاسَ وَلَا يَصْبِرُ عَلَىٰ أَذَاهِمْ. A believer who interacts with people and show patience to them is better than a believer who neither interacts with them nor shows patience to them. But this means interacting in doing good, not interacting in doing nothing or in doing evil, of course. Okay, here comes a problem. The brothers who work in the human development, they tell me, what you are saying is very negative. We want people to be proud of themselves. We want people to be happy with their talents and to know that they are talented. Here is the point, the difference. It is okay to use your given gifts that Allah gave you in the service of people, but you have to refer them to Allah always. So don't be proud of yourself, but be happy that Allah gave you a gift and use this gift in serving people, and let know that it can be taken away from you at any time. So this gift is not personal. So no problem to know that you are gifted. You have to know that you are gifted. Okay? But keep in mind that someone gave it to you and can take it at any time. It's not personal. It's something out of your own self. Fame. If you become famous, fame makes people gather around you, praise you frequently. Don't seek fame. I have sat with people and they said, my ambition is to be famous one day. What's that? It's not something good. Don't seek fame. Don't make it one of your dreams. It is so dangerous. But if it happens, keep reminding yourself with your weaknesses. Weaknesses. A famous person, a queen, a king, a president. Look at him when he's having diarrhea. Looks like an idiot. Runs to bathrooms. If someone is in the bathroom, he keeps knocking the door. Oh, quick, open for me quickly. So these things are gifts actually from Allah. Diarrhea and constipation, because they remind us with their weakness. We can't even control this in ourselves. We can't even control it when we want, for example, to sleep. You want to sleep? Insomnia overcomes you. You want to stay awake? Sleep overcomes you. How weak you are. How can you be proud of yourself with this weakness? So when you become famous, or if you become famous, God forbids, actually remind yourself with your weaknesses. You are a human being, a weak person. Make dua to Allah that He keeps you always remembering that you are a human being, and that your reality and that you are a weak person. Without him, you are nobody. Harun al-Rashid. He used to look at any cloud and feel like, rain whatever you want. You will rain in my land. He was ruling half the known world at that time, Harun al-Rashid. And then his scholar wanted to teach him a lesson. He told him, he has authority and he has a big kingdom. How much would you pay if you're deprived from water for 3 days? How much would you pay for some water like just as small as this amount? A sip of water. And he said, I would pay half of my kingdom for this sip of water if I'm deprived from water for 3 days. And then the man told him, and what if it is stuck, it's stuck in your body and you're unable to urinate? How much would you pay to get the water out? He said, the other half of my kingdom. So the man said, alas, for a kingdom that doesn't worth a sip of water, drinking it and peeing it. When you become famous, for example, listen to people, sit with people and listen and don't talk. So act humbly. Pray on the dust. Sit on the floor, sit on the dust, eat on the floor to remind yourself of who you are. Sit with the poor people, sit with the less fortunate people. When you become a person of authority, you have your own bathroom, you have your own, the food comes to your room. No. Go and eat outside with the rest of the employees. Be with them. Don't separate yourself from them. Because like that, you will think that you are special. You are a special creature, a VIP creature. It's not true. You're from dust. You see this dust that disgusts you sometimes? You're from that. When you become in authority, actually authority makes people forget their ubudiyya, servitude, and forget to be humble, and forget their weaknesses. And this authority becomes fitna. Fitna, the biggest fitna is authority for your nafs. Temptation. Fitna here is temptation. How to besiege your ego when you become in an authority position. Number one, do not seek to be in a position of authority unless there is real benefit for the ummah. So don't try to be the head of IFE, the head of MAB, the head of any organization. Just be there, one of the members, and work and do effort to benefit the community. But don't seek to be the director or the president. Don't seek authority positions. If you are given authority without asking it, be careful from the temptation, because it's very tempting. Ask advice continuously. When you become in authority, ask advice from people. When you ask advice from people, this is destroying your ego. Because actually, when you are in authority, people come to you, can I come in for 5 minutes? Yes, okay, brother, you can sit. Can I seek your advice? Yeah, okay, tell me what you want. Ego is inflating. Inflating. So when you become an authority, you go to people and ask their advice. Go and to an employee and say, can I take an advice from you? I need to do this and that. What do you think I should do? This is destroying the ego. It's hard, by the way. It's hard to do that. Go against your inclinations. Go against your desires. Act humbly. Actually, when you benefit the community and do a service for the community, this can make people praise you. And praising you can also lead that you feel that you're better. You're useful. You're beneficial. You're higher in rank. And this feeling may lead you to remind them
which means al-man wal-adha. This is very, very dangerous that you do man and adha for people. The verse says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُبْطِلُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى. Al-man is reminding people of your favors. So you do a favor and then when you see them, you remind them that, you know who did this for you? It's me. This is called man. Adha, the harm is when you make them feel that they did not deserve it. And you did it for them even though they did not deserve it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, O you who believe, do not cancel your charitable deeds with reminders and hurtful words. It is better for you not to do a good deed than doing it and then remind people with it and do hurtful deeds. So when you do someone a favor, you got someone a job. Not every time you see him, you ask him about, are you comfortable in your job? If he's not comfortable, he will tell you, yeah. You're really not worried about him comfortable or not. You just are reminding him. Are you comfortable with your job? Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. I told you in the beginning of this workshop that we do a lot of good deeds. But most of it is not for the sake of Allah. You got someone a flat. Every time you see him, are you comfortable in your flat? Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. Sick. Wallahi, we're sick. Spiritually sick. So all what we are here about is to treat ourselves from this sickness. And then, of course, you know that he will tell you, of course, I'm very comfortable in my flat. May Allah يعني, make everybody like you. This is what you want. This is actually what you're waiting for. May you always be there to help us. So every time you see him, comfortable in your flat? What's the antidote? When you start feeling that the microbe of pride started to enter to your heart and that you are spiritually weak, in case you become famous or in authority or when praised, there's an antidote, which is criticize yourself publicly. Criticize yourself. Like you criticize people, say, this person is too rushy. He always rushes. He always does things without advice, without consultation. Can you do this to yourself? Can you say, by the way, one of my shortcomings is that I am too rushy. Rarely when I seek advice from people, I just rush and I do things and then I regret later on. Can you criticize yourself in front of people? Why not? Why not? I told you about seeking the advice that Sheikh Ali Tantawi, one day, yani his granddaughter told us, or I wrote in a book, that he used to bring all his grandchildren, seat them around him, and bring a paper and a pen and tell him, yalla, tell me what is grandpa's shortcomings. What do you think? What do I need to fix in myself? And the kids say, what? You want us to tell you your shortcomings? They said, yes, of course. I want to know my shortcomings in order to fix them. So all of them grew up having no problem with criticism. Halos. Actually, they like criticism because it helps them find their own shortcomings. When someone criticizes you, maybe he's right. He made you a favor. He told you about a shortcoming. Maybe he's wrong. May Allah forgive him. Halos. Think about it. Abu Bakr Siddiq, he said, وَلِيتُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَلَسْتُ بِخَيْرِكُمْ. I became an authority of you. I'm authorized now, and I am not the best among you, even though he is the best actually among them. I said, I'm not the best among you. Do things that makes people, yani if you're rich, not necessarily that you drive Mercedes. It's okay to drive Mercedes, by the way. But don't feel ashamed of driving a cheap car. If you feel like it's embarrassing for you to be riding or driving a cheap car, here you have pride. So it's okay to be rich. It's okay to drive Mercedes. But it's not okay
to be ashamed of cheap cars. This means that you have a disease. It's okay to wear something nice, beautiful, and even if it's expensive. But it's not okay to be ashamed of wearing something cheap. So if you want to humble yourself, go and buy the cheap clothes from Primark or what they sell in the market and wear them in public. Why not? Not necessarily everything you wear is Lacoste, is Polo, is blah, blah, blah. Not necessarily. Okay? And it's okay to wear these things, but I'm telling you, if you are embarrassed when you are seen with something cheap, then you have a problem. Okay. Seek the advice of others. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Al-mu'min mir'atu akhih." A believer is a mirror for his brother. And we said before, what do we see in our mirrors? What do we see in the mirror? Not ourselves. You want to see yourself? Carry a picture for yourself. Every time you want to see yourself, look at the picture. But in the mirror, you see your shortcomings. You stand up in the mirror to fix your shortcomings. This needs to be fixed, and this needs to be fixed. As soon as the shortcomings that can be fixed are fixed, you go. That's what you see in the mirror. The Prophet said, a believer is a mirror for his brother. So a believer tells his brother or her sister about her shortcomings. Do that with your brother. Of course, don't go and advise your brother. No, he should seek advice from you. When someone seeks your advice, advise him. If you want to advise someone, there is adab. There is etiquettes. Don't advise him in public. Like the woman who said to the person, put your hands on your mouth. This is fadiha, this is a scandal, not an advice. So advice should not be public. You should go to someone and tell him, by the way, the Prophet said, "Ad-dinu nasiha," that we have to do nasiha, we have to do advice, and there is something, brother, that I want to tell you. If you allow me, I will tell you. You tell you, okay, go ahead. Are you sure? No hard feelings? No hard feelings. Brother, I have seen you doing this and that. I just wanted to understand. Like that. So there is adab. Don't intimidate people. Don't offend people. Yani you better yani keep your mouth shut than offend people. The ulama said, لِيَكُنْ لَكَ أَخٌ تَنْصَحُ وَيَنْصَحُكَ. The best thing is if you have a brother, a close brother to you, that you both advise each other all the time. So someone whom you appoint him to advise, and he appoints me to advise. You know who did that? Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the Khalifa. The Khalifa, the head of the Muslim state, he told his ex-slave, Muzahim, ex-slave, that he freed, and he told him, I am appointing you to be watchful of me, to watch me, and criticize me, and tell me about anything that I do, or any word that I say that should have not been done or said. This is your job. Job to criticize me. Because he's smart. He is focusing on what? On what he will be held accountable for on the day of judgment. Others who are not smart, they focus on their rights, not on their duties. You will be accountable for your duties, not your rights. And if every one of us focuses on his duties, what are the duties? It's somebody else's rights. Focus on your duties, which are somebody else's rights. If we all do that, we will all be having our rights. Lady Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. She gave in charity a abaya that she has, that when she wore, she liked it. Said, wow, this looks beautiful when I wear it. Okay, donate it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. None of you believers will attain true piety unless you give out of what you cherish. Whatever you give, God knows about it very well. Because actually, yeah, when do we give out a plate of potatoes that we made at home, what we cooked? It's when it started to smell. When it starts smelling, we give it quickly to any poor person. Is this giving what you cherish? Allah said, give what you cherish. When you cook it, cook it. When it's hot and fresh, give it for charity. But there are some people who give in charity a lot. What are their old clothes? Not new clothes. Old food, just before it rots. What's that? You're giving to Allah what you hate. Give to Allah what you love. Prepare some ready phrases and answers to say when you are praised. So for example, when someone tells you, you know what, I've seen you, you know, driving this Mercedes. Tell you, you know what, brother, I'm originally from a very poor family. I'm originally from a lower middle class. Originally, I was that. So you do something, you shock him, and at the same time, you're destroying the ego. Because when he tells you, I've seen you driving a Mercedes, you feel like, wow, yes, I am Ibn Nas, and I am someone from, always like that, all my family. No. Shock him. For example, when someone speaks highly of you, that is, the Prophet ﷺ taught us to say, Allahumma ja'alni khayran mimma yadhunnun waghfir li ma la ya'lamun. You tell them, oh, may Allah make me better than what you think and forgive me for what you don't know about me. This is what the Prophet told us to say to people when they praise us. May Allah forgive me for what you don't know about me. The substitute of the pleasure of the soul that results from praise is the happiness of the heart. Feeling the company of Allah when you do dhikr, when you read the Quran, when you speak to Him. So what I'm telling you, yes, it's true that you will not be feeling the happiness that comes when you are praised, because you won't be praised anymore. But at the same time, instead, you will have something better, which is the happiness of being fi ma'iyyatillah, in the company of Allah. Those who love the Quran, actually they love Allah, because those are the words of Allah. Our homework, actually we will resume inshallah after Ramadan, but cook and make food. You prepare food yourself for less fortunate people and for the poor. Don't just donate and people do not. You yourself go and cook for them and serve them. If you have, by the way, employees, if you have people working for you at home, some of us, they have maids who work at home and help and as helpers and stuff like that. And they make dinner at night. Did you ever think about making dinner for them one day? Make dinner for them and serve them one day. They are serving you every single day. I know that you pay them, but one day you serve them and see how hard it is to go and serve someone. Serve them. So cook for people, serve people, humble yourself. Again, I remind you with Ramadan, don't waste Ramadan. Ramadan is a good chance. It's like there are businessmen in this world who don't waste any chance. There is also businessmen of the hereafter who don't waste any chance. Be the businessmen of the hereafter who do not waste chances. This coming month, which will start inshallah within 24 hours or 48 hours, is a very blessed month. And at the same time, it is something that we should not waste. Spend as much as possible with the Quran. Ponder about the Quran. Try to find the hidden messages that are sent to you in the Quran. This Ramadan should be Ramadan of the quality ibadat, not the quantity ibadat. We spoke about that before. Your ibadah, the way you read the Quran, the way you pray, should be with good quality, not with quantity. I don't care if you read the whole Quran or not during Ramadan, but spend 3, 4, 5 hours every day reading the Quran. Even if you spend 3, 4, 5 hours pondering about one verse, good. Good. No problem. But take your time Ponder about the words of Allah. Try to find what the Quran is telling you. Quality, not quantity.
جزاكم الله خيرا. بارك الله فيكم. See you inshallah after Ramadan. Don't forget. Let us all inshallah make dua for each other.